Broadcasting from New York City, you're residing in Trunk Nation with host Eddie Trunk on SiriusXM's Hair Nation.
I must admit I have some ulterior motives at times when I play songs from some of my favorite artists of all time that come in the studio, because I figure, well, let me play this really kind of deep track that I love, that I'd love to hear the band play live, and then maybe they'll hear it and say, hey, why don't we work this one up on the next tour? So there's Saints in Hell from Stained Glass. Any ideas, guys? Did it get
you
thinking?
You should say that, Eddie. We were just talking about Love Bites and some of the tracks that we haven't played for years, and just how heavy they'd be now. Saints in Hell. I mean, it's just classic heavy Priest, and it would be good. When you go back and you listen to some of these songs, you think, why haven't we played that at all in some cases, or for so many years? So I think, the dates that we're planning to do in the fall or around the fall, I think you'll find there'll be a few tracks like that appearing.
Well, we need to get into all this, and we will, of course. That was Glenn Tipton speaking. Good to see you, Glenn.
Yeah, good to see you, Eddie.
And the Metal God right in front of me,
hello,
Mr.
Eddie.
Rob Halford.
Hi,
always
everybody.
Good to see you, Rob.
Yeah, good to see you again, man.
And Richie Faulkner is here. Good to see you, Richie.
You too, brother. Great to be here.
You're very tan. Where did you come from?
I came from Barbados.
I think
down in the Caribbean, yes.
Wow, that must be nice, huh?
It's tough down there, you know.
Rock star.
On the beach with a beer, and you got to keep the flag flying.
Look at this. So wait a minute. So how long have you lived in Barbados?
On and off for just over 2 years now, on and off, when we're not touring or working or promoting stuff. You know, it's a good little haven to go down and visit and, you know, sink a few beers.
He phones us from Barbados and baits us. You know, we're stuck in England in the rain and the grime.
Slow,
and
it's too warm over here, man.
The Birmingham.
And he just like, goes, yeah, I'm just drinking a nice cold beer on the beach.
And now, what, Glenn, didn't you live in Spain, or you were living in Spain for a while, right?
I did, yeah.
No more?
I don't live in Spain, actually. I live in the Balearic Islands.
Is it, I'm
Ibiza.
An idiot. Is that where? Oh, Ibiza.
You went back to Ibiza?
Oh, okay.
All those Priest years, screaming for vengeance.
I still live in England. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So you live in both places then?
Well, mainly England. England is my main home, I'd say.
Very, very cool. So listen, the most exciting thing is that you're all sitting here about to release new Priest music.
Which we wanted to play, but you've turned us down.
I would never turn you down. I want to play it, but I can only play it on the air, and you can't play it on the air yet.
Yeah, but if people knew what you were listening to, they'd put up with a moment's silence.
You think so?
I think so.
But the problem is I could play it in cue, but we'd be hearing it in mono on one little speaker here.
Oh, yeah.
It still works. Probably,
does it still cut through, Rob?
Mm.
Well, before we have one new song that we can play that's been making the rounds, and we'll talk about that in a second. But talk about the fact that we're even here with new Priest music, because, Rob, you told me when you walked in, which I can't believe, we're talking about how time moves faster as we get older.
Yes.
Nostradamus is 6 years old?
6 years old. Happy birthday to you.
Is that right? I didn't know.
It's been six years since we did Nostradamus.
Wow.
Has anybody got a CD to look at the date?
It took about six years to record.
Am I making it up?
What? 2008.
It's just 2008.
It took 6 years to
Thank
record.
Thank you. So what, 6 years? 6 years has whizzed by. But in that time, of course, we did not only the Nostradamus tour, then we did the Epitaph tour as well. And then we got into writing mode and made Redeemer of Souls, so we ain't been hanging out
and
doing nothing.
It's 18, 19 tracks? I can never remember.
18 tracks?
Yes.
So there's a big chunk of work there, you know, but we enjoyed it. Right, it's right back to the roots of Priest. It's classic Priest.
When we finished Epitaph, we just got so buzzed from the fans and the reaction wherever we went, and just to put the Epitaph tour together, which was we tried to put a song from every record into the show, and we were living in the life of Judas Priest all those decades in one show, night after night on the world trek, and I think that really did something to us internally as musicians. It should do when you tour. So we realized that this next record really had to be, you know, a really strong, full of energy, because it's relentless. The tracks are relentless. The energy that you feel off Redeemer of Souls is replicated in that direction time and time and time again.
Well, let's backtrack a second here, because I want to talk about the new music, but I want to talk about how we got here, because you mentioned Nostradamus, and let's start from that point. that record was something that I know you guys put a lot into making it. And there's a lot of stuff on that record I truly love. But in retrospect, now looking back on it, do you feel that maybe it was a little bit too ambitious of a project? Do you think the timing was right? Do you think that the fans connected with it in the way you had hoped?
What are you trying to say, Eddie?
Are you glad you did it? Do you feel good about the record still?
I'm kidding. It's my weird English sense of humor.
No, I know you. I know what you're saying. Are you happy you did it, though?
Yeah, absolutely proud of the album. It was a little bit off the wall, and it wasn't quite what people expect, or a small element people expected from Priest, and maybe they would prefer a more Priest classic album. But I've said many times, you know, we've done it now with Redeemer of Souls, a completely classic Priest album. They'll probably the same element will turn around and say, I wish I'd tried something a bit different, you know.
So yeah, of course.
You can't please all of the people all of the time, or some of the people some of the time, whatever that saying is. But we enjoyed writing. A lot of it was done on keyboards, wasn't it? Nostradamus. We wanted a classical feel in places, an operatic feel in places. We wanted to do a concept album. We've always wanted to, and something that was a bit different. And we've never been afraid to experiment and try. You know, you've got to do that.
It goes back to Turbo. All that stuff.
Absolutely,
yeah.
Absolutely. And if you ever hear us play Turbo Lover on stage, it's one of the heaviest songs we ever do, you know. So you never know how it's going to turn out, but you've got to try these things, and we were very proud of that album. And people, the small element again that said we want, you know, think more classic Priest. We listened, and you got to listen to your fans, and that's what we've done now. And you couldn't have a more classic album than Redeemer of Souls.
Well, Rob, you had said your thing when we were talking a lot about Nostradamus at the time it was out is you still had this vision of doing it in a theater, start to finish, and the many costume changes you would go through.
Well,
you
I still
hope
believe
to do that.
I
one day?
Yeah, I still see this whole idea came from Bill Kerbishley, our manager, along with Jane Andrews, has been looking after the band for 30 odd years. And there's a lot of thought that we respect from management, and Bill especially, because of his work with The Who and Tommy, looking after Pete and Roger and so on. And the story goes, we were out together somewhere in the world one day, and we had lunch, and he said, I want to talk about an idea that I've got that I'd like you to think about. And he knew we'd been wanting to make this concept record for as long as he'd been managing us. And we sat down and we said, okay, what is it, Bill? He goes, Nostradamus. And that was it. He just said Nostradamus. Instantly, you go, it's a hole in one. Because Bill thinks a lot about all of these possibilities. And so the fact that just sparked an immediate connection. Now we've got the material, the idea, rather, to put the material together about this fabled prophecia, and who still talked about 300 years later, still is relevant. He's a man that everybody knows from all walks of life. You don't need to be a metalhead. So there's this big story attached to him, and then beyond that, musically, you can do many things. I think that I was listening to Nostradamus when I was flying out here from San Diego. I listened to the whole record again, and there's some really heavy stuff on that.
I love
on that
Death.
Album.
Death is amazing.
You know, it's a great display of the versatility of metal.
Yes.
So, just to finish off my speech here, I still feel that there's still stuff to do with that record, and we've got some things on the back burner which we can't discuss right now, but there's more of this idea of bringing other elements of Nostradamus to our audience, to our fans, in many, many different ways. So it's one of, sometimes these songs or these concepts take a long time to fully blossom, so to speak. So I think there's still life in the old Nostradamus yet.
Yeah, I believe so. And as we said earlier on, we're talking about it earlier on, it's not only his visions and, you know, the four horsemen that used to visit him, and God knows what he was taking anyway at the time, but we could do some. But it's not just that. It's his life that intrigued us. It was, you know, full of tragedy in a way. He got kicked out of France, and then he came back and he found a new love. His first wife and his daughter died in the plague. So, there were two elements to it, two aspects to it, two ways of looking at it, which was his visions, which has got plenty of scope to write songs around, and his actual life as well.
Personal
and
life.
I don't know where it all came from, but it just flooded out of us. And I think if you've got subject matter that's so intriguing, it does just flood out of it.
Well, and the reason why I'm bringing up the previous record is, first of all, I can't believe it's 6 years, but obviously Redeemer of Souls is the next record.
Yes, and that's what's important, right. just to finish this whole thing off. If you look at bands of longevity, like Priest, you see the trail of music that we've left. I don't think we could have probably made as great a record as we have with Redeemer of Souls if we didn't have Nostradamus as a reference point, you know?
It's like a stepping stone.
It's a stepping stone to the next place. Every Priest record, as you know, Eddie, because you're a long-time Priest fan, every record that we've made, we've tried to give it some distinction, some separate identity. British Steel doesn't sound like Stained Class. Stained Class doesn't sound like Painkiller. Painkiller doesn't sound like Defenders of the Faith.
Point of Entry doesn't sound like the record that came before or after.
Exactly.
Right.
So I think everything has its place and has its moments, and we've always fed off these different areas that we've gone into with our metal. So thanks to Nostradamus, we've got Redeemer of Souls.
Now, you go out on tour, and after that you do a tour called Epitaph, where a lot of Priest fans took that as being the end of the band. And that's when KK leaves, and in comes Mr. Faulkner, who's sitting here, does a brilliant job on stage playing those shows, and is quickly accepted by the Priest fans. I think everybody would agree.
Yep.
But you kind of started out as somewhat, and correct me if I'm wrong, Epitaph being somewhat of a farewell of sorts, and then halfway through it kind of pulled back and said, maybe not, which is why I think we're all sitting here today. Mm-hmm. So talk about that part of the equation, Richie coming in and then kind of changing gears a bit during that tour.
You know, Richie came in, energized the band a lot. And when I say that, before anybody, you know, reads it wrong, I'm talking about energized me, certainly. You know, I'm getting on a bit now. And we're all from a different generation that Richie comes from. So he came in and really did energize the band. And not only that, his contribution, particularly to the writing, is unbelievable, because he came in and fitted in, slotted in straight away. But that's because he did his homework. He's always been a Priest fan. He listened to Priest, and he knew what he'd got to bring to the table, and he brought exactly the right things to the table, so that we'd got a new angle at looking things, but it's still very much Judas Priest. So
are you saying, Glenn, that you're pretty much crediting Richie, kind of changing the title?
I'm going to give him bags of money later on.
For more or less changing the tide, so to speak, once you got out there on the road with Epitaph, where you kind of said, maybe we want to do this some more?
In all honesty, we always said, we never really changed our mind, that Epitaph was the last world tour we were going to do. There was a possibility we would always do more dates. And so, you know, we stuck to our guns here. We weren't trying to trick people by saying it was our last tour. It was our last world tour. That it can take a chunk out of your life, Eddie. You know, you know yourself, work takes a big part of your life. And when you go out on tour, it takes a chunk out of your life. So I think we're re-energized now with the new album out, Enthusiasm. I think it makes you think twice, how can I give this up, you know? How could I possibly give this up? And that drives you on. And it's driven us on for 40 years, and we're still alive, and barely, but we're still alive.
It all comes about, like we've said a million times, and we'll say a million times again, it's all down to the fans. The fans constantly motivate us. We've never, and we will never ever, you know, ignore the fact that without our incredible Judas Priest fans, we wouldn't have had the life that we've had. So at the end of that Epitaph tour, you know, you go home for the first time in almost 2 years, and you're thinking about all of that great emotion, and it's very difficult to say that's the end of that. It's the end, you know. But we're refocusing, and we are going to go out, not as extensively. We feed on the energy that the fans give us, as we've always said, and they were the inspiration for us to put together Redeemer of Souls. We were thinking all the time about how would the fans react to this vibe or that vibe, and that's not to say that we were letting somebody else take our musical direction, but it's great to have that understanding, to have a reference point of who puts you where you are, and it just, when you've been doing it for 40 years, you're thinking a lot more about things that you didn't when you first kicked off, because at the beginning you're just very organic and you don't have a big fan base, there's a purity, like we've always said, with a lot of bands, to some extent, the some of the best moments happen in the first two or three releases, and then all the other things start to come into play.
For you guys, the big breakthrough stuff came 5-6 albums in.
Yeah,
later into the process.
That's right. So as soon as we established this incredible fan base, the fans have always been with us internally.
Rob, let me ask you, and then I want to get to Richie about a few things, and of course talk in more in depth about the new record that's coming out and all your plans. But Glenn touches on the fact that you guys have been doing this 40 years, and that slowing down a little bit, time stops for nobody. We all get older. Mm. We all know it. We talked about it off mic before. Time seems to be moving faster as we all get older. You, as the front man, as the singer, as the metal god, as the guy who's got to sing all this stuff. I just played Saints in Hell before, which is up in the stratosphere. Mm. How are you feeling these days?
I could do that song. It would be different, but I could do it. I mean, I think you could, you know, you could challenge us to do any Priest song, and we could play it as Judas Priest in 2014. That's the joy that we experience now, and it'll be fun to pick the set list for these next shows that we're considering doing. So
he's mentioned it again, by the way. He's chiseling away.
I know he wants
to. Don't get me started. I'm just curious about, because you had some back issues. I know you just, we talked about that on the air.
Yeah, the last time I was here, I was in a wheelchair, but I bounced back.
I forgot. Metal, wait a minute. I just forgot about that. It was, oh my gosh, was that a vision? You were here, right, Jay? Richie pushing Rob Halford through Times Square in a wheelchair. I mean, talk about, I thought it was just a hazing for you, Richie. I thought that was just something like part of a hazing.
I mean, it was pretty surreal. I mean, 5 years ago, you'd never imagine you're going to be pushing Rob around Times Square in a wheelchair. It was just pretty surreal, you know. And we took a photo of it and put it out on the social networks, and people went nuts. You know, they thought it was hilarious, and it was. I mean, and Rob took it really well. He was, you know, he was fighting on in true fashion, you know.
Oh, that's around the same time that we did the movie premiere that you guys had me host here, the Epitaph premiere, because you rolled up at that as well.
Rolled down the aisle in the wheelchair.
But your back problems are behind you.
I had back surgery, and thanks to Spencer Harland, this amazing neurospinal surgeon, he cut me open, diced and sliced me, sewed me back up, and I sprang out of bed screaming for vengeance.
So as a result, Richie and you got to walk in side by side as opposed to him pushing you.
Yes, that was great. great moment today.
And now we mentioned, Richie, you've been in 3 years now?
3 years. I joined the band in 2011, start 2011.
And Rob was saying off mic before we started talking, your first couple of Priest gigs were exactly what again?
I think it was just over 30 million people on the American
30 million? Idol. 30 oh, million. Watching.
30 million watching. And it is a big, you know, ask, really. You've got that in the back of your head, in the back of your mind. You know that there's 30-odd million people watching you. You better not fuck up, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's no second takes. You're on, and off you go, you know. It's just lucky that there wasn't 30 million people physically in the room watching you, because that would have been a bit daunting, I think.
I didn't see that. Did you guys actually play live or to a track for that?
Played live.
It was well, what did you say, Glenn?
Can't say.
Well, because a lot of TV, it's no secret that sometimes it's partially a track, because for the television purposes, but
yeah.
I'm just wondering if, you know, Richie had to actually play during that, or you just kind of had to go through the motions.
I can't remember that one. I can't remember. I might be getting mixed up with the Jimmy Fallon one, but I remember was it that one that we played live?
We did it three live shows around about that time. They're all it's testing.
It was testing, because there's no second chance.
We just thought we'd give him a real good test, and then we tested him. What was it?
What was the second test, Rob? You had mentioned it before.
When we headlined Sweden Rock Festival a few days later.
That was a big one. So he really was thrown in the deep end.
Well, now we have a new record coming out, Redeemer of Souls. And in a lot of way, Richie, for you, this has got to be as big as those moments must have been. This has got to be a huge moment, because very few people, unless you're a drummer, have played on a Priest record besides, you know, the core four. I joke because you guys had a lot of drummers back in the day, but outside of that position in the band, now Scott's been there. Now Scott's not the new guy anymore.
No.
After 20-something years.
That's right. He's finally
in. So for you, though, to finally put your stamp on a new record, you're on the Epitaph Live stuff, but to put your stamp on a new pre-studio record, and it's got to feel like really a big, the final hurdle to really feel in this band.
Well, it was an incredible honor to be a part of it. I mean, since day one, you know, since the band said you're in, you've got the job, from day one there's been creative input from all sides. You know, it's not a situation where there's maybe two people that run the whole show and everyone else just turns up and plays. It's not like that at all. There was discussions about the set list or changing songs or input into the set design or the production, or you know what I mean. So right from the word go, it was very inclusive, like a, you know, like a creative family. And that dynamic has kind of spread throughout, you know, my 3 years in Priest into the writing, you know, included in that. And we were out on tour during the Epitaph tour. I had a recording rig out on the road with me. So I'd go back, you know, in the dressing room, spend a few hours putting down riffs. Rob would poke his head round the door and say, oh, what's that? What's that you're putting down? I've got an idea for that. Or Glenn would come in the room with his guitar and say, I've got this riff. Can you put this down? So it started very organically. You know, we were out on the road putting down riffs. And when it came to the time to actually sit down, get together, put the ideas in the pot, if you will, for the Redeemer of Souls record, we'd already started. You know, it was an organic process, and they've been, as I said, inclusive. You know, from the beginning. So,
well, from my standpoint, I can see that you're not that's definitely the case, and I'll tell you why. A lot of times, a band is established as Priest when they bring a new member in, especially after all these years. Sometimes they don't even include them in the press photo, let alone from day one. Right. You're sitting here, you know, with Rob and Glenn.
I mean, the press photos anymore.
But you know what I'm saying? Absolutely, there's a lot of quote unquote hired gun situations. Yeah. We don't really include this guy.
Right.
Nobody speaks to him, what have you.
Right.
But you were here with Rob for Epitaph, and you know, you're here now. So right out of the chute, you were definitely, it seems like, not only welcomed by the fans, but given an equal playing field with the band. That had to feel great.
It's got to be, we were talking about this earlier, Eddie, that, you know, a band isn't as big as just one person. You know, Scott's as important to this band as Ian, as I am, as Glenn, as Richie. It's just everybody's playing a very vital, important role to the overall sound when you're recording, the overall performance when you're live. And we've always made sure that we understand that about each other. Just because you're holding the mic doesn't make you any more important or less important than the next guy. It's the collective energy and the collective enthusiasm and drive to get the best metal that you can make that we've always felt is vital to Priest's existence. So when Richie came in, Richie was in. It wasn't like, you know, you'll be in 10, 15 years, whatever. It's now, you know. We got to make a record, we've got to do a tour, you know, and...
Priest's always been connected. A family, hasn't he?
Yeah,
and, you know,
very much a family.
It still is. And if there's anything any one person doesn't want to do, we don't do it.
And I think as a result of that, everyone is on the same page, everyone's on the same side, and it's only going to benefit, you know what I mean? We're all metal fans, we're all music fans. You know, I'm a big fan of the band before being out on the outside and now being on the inside. So I feel like I've got a duty as an individual and as part of the family, you know, and as a fan to do the best you can and fly the flag for metal, as Priest has always done.
For sure. Have you guys ever written on the road before this record? Is that something
that you guys did? We haven't. We very rarely would write on the road. We always used to like to take a break after the end of a tour. I used to, speaking from my own point of view, I used to put the guitar down for weeks or months sometimes, but then when I picked it up, I'd do intensive bursts of work, and that was when I was my most prolific, because I was enjoying playing the guitar again instead of playing it every day and getting, you know, monotonously bored with it. And so we always used to take a break, and then we'd write and then record and then go on tour again. But it was different this time because, you know, you've got a lot of spare time. You either stay in your hotel room all day and just vegetate or go down to the gig, which is what Richie did, and kick some songs and ideas and riffs around, and we'd be there as well, and suddenly you pick up on things. And so it was a little bit unusual for us. A lot of ideas were born out on the road.
Why do you think it took so long to get this record ready? It seems like, I mean, maybe it's just me being an anxious fan, but it seems like it took a little longer than normal to get this record together. Was it just
some breaks? If you do break it down, I mean, if you take all the breaks out of it, we were doing the usual Monday to Friday thing, you know, from starting the mid-morning and finish...
In the UK? Did you record in the UK?
At night. So yeah. we were committed to.
We also did a tour in the middle of it.
There was a tour in the middle, yeah.
Yeah, we took a tour.
Went out on tour and then had another writing session after that. So,
and who did you guys produce it yourselves or?
Glenn with Mike Exeter, who worked on the Sabbath album.
And I did my little bit, but Mike has done a great job on the sound on the album. He's worked over and above the Call of Duty. He deserves a lot of credit for it.
So when can we get it? When is it coming out? What's the release date?
July 15th
in the States.
Oh, so a ways away yet. We're still going to have to wait for a couple more months.
Well, on the 19th of May is the first official single.
March of the Damned.
See, Richie's in the band because he remembers the dates.
He does. He's great. He's great.
Yeah, you know.
I saw Jay nodding at him. That's the right date. Like, and Richie's going to do all the heavy lifting.
So that's the next thing to, you know, the next thing that's going to happen. So it is, it's a, you know, a few weeks away. But there'll be some surprises along the way. So you won't be starved.
How many songs on the record?
We were going to play 19 seconds of the first song. I don't know whether we'll be allowed to do that.
Your manager makes the call. She's in here.
What do you think, guys?
19 seconds. Why 19 seconds versus like 23 seconds?
I don't know why I said 19 seconds.
What is 19? No, 18 tracks. No, it's 13.
We get into trouble, I think, with the record company.
Well, we should play. We're going to play Redeemer of Souls. She's waving the CD in front of me, just completely taunting me right now. Mm-hmm.
We just had a before we came over to see her, we actually had a playback at Epic with the boss, L.A. Reid, and it's just really great that L.A. showed up and was there, you know, really enthusiastic. The label is incredibly supportive of this record,
which is amazing when you think about it, because who's left who even has a record deal anymore? Yeah. And you guys have a major record deal. You've had that association for decades. I mean, that's amazing.
There's a tremendous energy from the label about this record. They've all heard the tracks and they're really focused, and there's a big buzz at Epic about the hopes that we're going to achieve on this release. It's 13 tracks on the single CD and 19 tracks on the other one with the...
No, leave the numbers to Richie because Jay's waving
18.
Right.
18.
Oh, God.
So it's 13 and 18.
It's me. I said 19 before.
You said 19.
Wait, so 13 and 18 is on what? What's on 18?
There's 13 tracks on the album.
Right.
And then there's 5 extra tracks.
And where will those come out? As B-sides or what have you?
It'll be on the deluxe version of the album.
And are any of the extra songs, are they covers, or are they all extra original material?
No, they're all great songs. The reason they're not on the album is because the 13 that we chose are very consistent with what we wanted to do, which was release an undisputable heavy metal album. The others, they're not lightweight by any chance, but they've got a different feel
texture,
to them. Yeah, different texture. And so it's not a case of, you know, trying to rip the kids off, trying to get more money for an extra album. It's just a case of these 5 tracks seem to deserve to go on their own CDs, and that's what we did.
We didn't want to drop the energy from the opening Thunder and Lightning thing on Dragonaut right up to the end of Battle Cry. It's just full on. It's relentless. It's great.
All right, well, we're going to play Redeemer of Souls, which is the song we can play. And then while this is playing, you can have a discussion with management and see if we get 19 or 23 or 21 seconds.
19 seconds.
Of another song.
Why did I say that? No, because there's 19 tracks on the album, but the reason there's 18.
That's why we're musicians.
That's why I'm getting an ear trumpet next week.
I figured there was this killer 19-second intro of Glenn going off he wanted everybody to hear. I don't know. But let me get to one more question before we play the song, because this is the one everybody's going to want to know, especially in light of the fact that you are not going to do global, worldwide touring as much as you did in the past. How much touring? Have you thought about that specifically here for, selfishly for the people listening here in the U.S. and Canada? Have you thought about, are you going to do a tour? Are you going to do just special events? Have you addressed that yet?
We spoke about it, yeah. It's all a little bit played by ear. We're looking at starting some dates in the fall. Exactly how many and what size, what capacity, we're not sure. But one thing that we have discussed, his priest have got such a wealth now of songs behind us. We probably won't go over the top on production like we've done before. The strength will be in the music. That's our feeling at the moment with this next tour.
We want to go back to basics to a certain extent.
Well, your music is so powerful. There's so much of it, and nobody needs to look any further than how that could work than when you stripped down to the barest moment when you did my radio show party 5 years ago.
That made us think about the next move, quite honestly. I mean, we'd never played like that for as long as we could remember.
Yeah, I mean, you guys just came up there basically in street clothes and
jammed.
played 40
great.
Minutes. And
it was amazing.
It's great, and we've done that. I remember when Ripper joined the band, we did the Boathouse somewhere in South Carolina. no, South Virginia.
Rob wasn't at that one.
Actually, it's West Scotland.
I was at the Boathouse in Nottingham.
It's West Scotland.
Rob was at a different Boathouse when you were playing that one with Ripper.
Well, which was 4,000 miles out, that's all.
But, I showed up at the Boathouse to see Ripper. It was in South Carolina.
And,
Lord.
You know, there have been a couple of times when we've done small clubs, and there's nothing more powerful than seeing Priest in a small venue.
No.
You know, the impact's just tremendous. So.
People are still talking about that event that you guys were so incredibly cool to play for me. And the one funny story I remember about that event was a couple days later, you guys had kicked off the tour. What was it, Metal Masters? Was that what it was? The Metal Masters tour? The one with Heaven and Hell that you were about to do.
Yes, with Motorhead and Testament.
Right, and I came to the first or second show, which was at the PNC Arts Center in New Jersey.
Yeah.
I think it was in August. It was like 110 degrees, and I'm standing by the side of the stage. And Rob, you came up in your full regalia and your leather coat and everything, and you just got in my ear and you go, "Bloody hell, Eddie, I wish I could play like I was just at your party the other day." But wearing, you had to be the metal god. You had to go out there like that.
Wearing 100 pounds of leather and steel instead of a baseball cap and shorts.
Yeah. I should, before I play the song, I'm hogging the time here. My good friend, Mr. Don Jameson, from my partner on that metal show, is here. Anything you want to say to the Priest?
No, look, I don't want to take time away from these guys, but the one point I will make is not only is this exciting for Priest fans that we're going to have a new album from the Mighty Priest, but also, you know, one of the cool things about doing the show is not only talking about new bands, but really letting people know, because a lot of people forget between New York and L.A., there's a lot of people who don't know what's going on like we do. We're a little more cosmopolitan. And it's so cool just to let our audience know that bands like Priest and Motorhead and Whitesnake and Saxon are still here and they're still making great music. And so not only is this a great celebration for Priest fans, but I think it's a great celebration for metal fans too.
Well said.
Yeah, thank you.
Absolutely. I was glad I gave him the microphone.
No,
you never
words,
know what's
Jim.
Going to come out of his mouth.
Good words. Yeah, we were talking earlier today about the old guard of heavy metal music still being vital and relevant and important, connecting through all the way to the new metal scene and all the incredible talent that's out there right now. It's just amazing, isn't it, that you've got the, sitting in this room now, you've got some of the originators of this great thing.
As I've said so many times, and ironically, you're from the same area, but Sabbath and you guys are the architects of heavy metal, in my opinion. And don't get me started on it, but you guys are the next band I'm going to start screaming about for that institution in Cleveland called the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, because it is disgraceful that you, to me, with Sabbath, the most important bands in the history of this genre, and you haven't been considered yet. So, listen, I've been lucky. I had Alice Cooper sit next to me, and I screamed about it on TV. He went in. I screamed about Rush going in. They went in. I screamed about Kiss going in. And now I'm not taking credit for this, but I'm just saying I'll dust off a little bit and get the Priest machine rolling.
Okay.
There's a song on the extra 5-track CD. Not 19, by the way. 18. It's called Never Forget, and there's a line in there Rob wrote, which I think sums it up. It says, all those moments that we shared, because it's to do with the audience, and all those dreams that we dared. And, you know, when you first start out, you do dream. And the reality, comes from those dreams. When you travel the world and play rock and roll, it's just a beautiful feeling.
Yeah, and there's the originators. I mean, you guys are still going. Sabbath is still out there, still going. Maiden still going. AC/DC now apparently going to still be going, but we don't know what's going on with Malcolm, obviously, what's come out. So, you know, some of the guys, unfortunately, the cracks are starting to show, and time stops for no one. It's hard. So you have to savor it. As fans, we savor and are so grateful of the originators, what you guys have left to give us. And judging from this track, there's still some more good stuff to come.
Yes. So yeah, absolutely. The passion hasn't diminished. The intent, you know, the love of what we do is probably stronger on this record than you've probably heard in a long time from Priest.
And I've said it a million times, and I'll say it again. No band has ever been as fiercely waving the flag defiantly for heavy metal than Judas Priest. No band has ever done that. You've got bands that have been metal bands, but no, they shied away from the term. They shied away from the imaging. We're not really metal. It's not cool to be. You guys, from day one till now, always proud to be metal. So I don't know if it bothers you about the Hall of Fame like it bothers me and the fans, but do you guys think about that? Does that bother you at all, or it's what is what it is?
I think it is what it is. I think when those moments, if and when they do happen, you should accept them, because it's not only you, it's the music that you love and the music that you write and you play, and it's the fans again. You know, if and when that day comes when we do get into Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, it's not just Priest, it's metal, and it's the fans, it's everybody together being recognized for the great force of music that we do.
Well, when you do it, just make sure it goes down the right way, not like what Kiss just did.
Okay.
Complaining, crying, kicking, screaming, I'm not playing with you, you're not playing with me.
Yeah, it's a bit silly.
It was ridiculous. Richie Faulkner, I can tell, is already going to be a problem when that day comes.
You can tell,
he's
right?
Got problem written all over him this
absolutely,
guy.
Absolutely. No, it does turn into, there's been a few acts over the last few years where it's turned into a bit of a, you know, it takes away a bit from the reason that they're there. You know, the squabbling going on within the band and which members, you know, I mean, I'd rightly, I think, step aside and let the original guys, you know, go in there and accept it if and when that did happen.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't there creating it when they were,
right.
You know. And I guess some people have different ideas about that, but I just think it turns into a bigger debacle than it needs to be, and they're there for a reason, and, you know, honor and appreciate that, I think.
Well, let's hope we have this to discuss for real very soon, because that would mean you guys are going in. Purple's not in, so don't even... Deep Purple's not in, we don't have to worry about anything, because that's beyond insane, too. All right, Redeemer of Souls, this track, title track from the new album, coming out in July. We're going to play it for you right now. If you haven't heard it yet, crank up the radio. Then we're going to come back. You cool with talking to the audience for a little bit?
Yeah. Sure. Yeah.
Okay, good. I'm on for about another 45 minutes, so we'll take some calls from the audience. I'm sure everybody would love to talk to Judas Priest in the studio. 3/5 of the band, Glenn Tipton, Rob Halford, Richie Faulkner. We'll take your calls right after we play the title track from the new Priest album coming out in a couple months, Redeemer of Souls.
Broadcasting from New York City, you're residing in Trunk Nation with host Eddie Trunk on SiriusXM's Hair Nation.
That is Priest in the title track from the new album, Redeemer of Souls, which will be coming out when, Richie Faulkner?
It is the 15th of July in the States.
Okay, I'm going to you for all dates from now on.
You put me on the spot now.
But sounding great, and very much sounding like an old school Priest approach. I mean, that sounds like something that could be on Sin After Sin.
Played it live.
To Myers. Best,
yeah, played it live with the drums alive and guitars alive, mic'd up to the cabinets and live vocals and... you know, very little, if any, processed sounds. And that's going to be great, just to transpose that into a live venue.
And you guys all were in the same room at the same time doing that?
For the most part, yeah.
We're not trying to say we did the album live, but we tried to create a live feel as much as possible. There's no programmed drums, there's no processed guitars. It's very much, you know, how you would record live.
Well, Glenn, as a guy who also does a lot of production work with the band, how do you feel about what a lot of people are doing now with the more program stuff and the Pro Tools versus there's a movement towards the other way too.
I think there's fors and against, you know, there's arguments for and against. Pro Tools is a great piece of equipment because you can, so, you know, we've done some songs in the past where perhaps the arrangement wasn't quite right, and you've always got that chance to go back and change it, you know, with Pro Tools. But unfortunately, you've got too many chances to go back and change things, and you can lose your way. I think you've got to take advantage of modern technology in production in some senses, but for this particular album, we're first and foremost known as a live act, and we wanted to try and create that on this album, and I think to a certain extent we've achieved that.
All right, let's get some of your calls on, because we have about 15 minutes left before you guys got to get out of here. So headphones at the ready, and here we go to talk to the public. Adam in San Francisco starts us off. Adam, you're on with Judas Priest.
Hey, guys, what an honor. Wow.
Hello, Adam.
Hi, Adam.
I really respect your career, and I've been listening to you since I was a wee little one, about 11 or 12, and I'm 42 now, so... I just saw Alice Cooper's documentary, and I really would love to see a documentary about your career and the ups and downs, and I wonder if that's ever been talked about or in the works.
Well,
great question.
Unfortunately, it's almost over, so no, it would be interesting. I'm sure there's a lot of old footage that would be interesting to people, and maybe, you know, somebody can pull that together. You're right, Adam, it would be really interesting. Showing the hardships, which we had plenty of in the early days, but it's on, you know, every band's been through the mill, and we're no exception, and you sort of achieve a success and it grows. So you're right, it would be an interesting documentary.
Sam Dunn does amazing work, and he's a hardcore metalhead rock fan. So I think if ever we did do it, I think we'd definitely consider Sam as the guy to piece it all together.
Yeah, I haven't seen the Alice one yet, but he did that. He did the Maiden one, the Flight 666. I forget he did the Headbanger's Journey. Yeah. He would be the logical choice.
And
I would think that you would be a logical target for him with something coming up, because as our caller Adam mentioned, I mean, the history, the ups, the downs, the ins, the outs, I mean, there's a lot to cover there.
I will say this, that I think part of a band's mystique and mystery is that, you know, most people know Priest just for our music, as they should. I think once you pull back the curtain, something gets a little bit diminished, you know. I don't know how I'm trying to express myself.
No, but
here,
that's but a good point, Rob.
I think that once you start talking about, you know, airing your dirty laundry or whatever, I think that that's not what people want. They want a band. They want the music. They want the show. Life is a challenge as it is. Without hearing that, I mean, we live the life like everybody else does. We've had our ups and downs like everybody else has. But is that important? Do you really want to know that? Because whatever's happened to you has probably happened to me. So let's just leave it at that. Let's just leave the power of the metal experience to speak for us. That I think is the greatest treasure that we've got in Judas Priest. You know, a lot of bands are very open about their displaying everything, and
well, social media plays big into that
exactly
too.
And we've never done that, Eddie. We've always it's about the book. We've never written the book, and I personally don't think we ever will, because that's not what we're about. We're fiercely protective of who we are as a band. It's just about the music. It really is that vital.
That's a great point too. Nobody in Priest has written a book, and everybody in the world is writing books these days.
You don't want to spill the beans.
And I don't think you should do it just because everybody else is doing it. That's not a reason. I think we've got to treasure everything about Judas Priest. If you want to know about this band, put on Rock-A-Roller, listen to everything from Rock-A-Roller to Redeemer of Souls. There's the life of Judas Priest.
Although I can see the wheels turning that Richie's going to write a book.
Oh, yeah.
Richie's
absolutely.
Richie's going to be the first one, my 3 years in Judas Priest.
I hadn't thought about it before, but now I'm thinking about it.
My 3 years of hell. But it was a good question, Adam.
All right, let's go to Wisconsin and say hello to Stan. Hi, Stan, you're on with Judas Priest.
Hey, how you doing, guys?
Hello, Stan. It's
an honor to be talking.
Good to speak with you. What's up?
Actually, to tell you the truth, I am a truck driver. I am out of Niagara Falls, Ontario, Canada.
Okay.
Wondering if you're going to be making it to Toronto, and if so, when you are playing there, like your playlist, are you going to be playing old stuff like Rock and Roll a Woman, you know, Diamonds and Rust?
Rock and Roll a Woman. I've said,
you're singing Rob's language right now.
I love all that. I'd love to do Dying to Meet You, down, 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 all that heavy stuff. Thank you for that question. We love our truck drivers. Bands can't do shows without the truck drivers that get the gear from place to place. Bless you for that. Yeah, I think that the you know, we'll look at the places that we're going to come to again, and as soon as we've got confirmation, just go to the pre-site and the dates will start going.
Well,
and we will be looking at all of the material like we always do. There's a wealth of possibilities.
Well, there's something else that ties into that too, which you guys kind of touched on. If you were to go out, and I think this would be really cool, and of course, if you did a stripped down tour and say you did something like a theater tour or something like that, the people that are going to come to that are going to be the more hardcore Priest fans that are going to truly know your catalog. So if you decided to go deeper and stay away from maybe some of the more known songs in exchange for these other songs you haven't played in a while, it would be a place where you could, I would think that audience would be more knowledgeable and receptive to that, versus, of course, if you play a big festival and you don't play, you got another thing coming, they're going to turn the chairs over.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be Madison Square Garden on the Defenders tour.
Yeah. There's to a certain extent, there is an obligation. You've got to do Breaking the Law. You've got to do Living After Midnight. We love playing those songs. But there's just a wealth of other material that we can dive into. I wish we had more time.
Yeah.
I'd love to play all of Rock and Roll live. I really would. I'd love to play all of Point of Entry live, you know, but the clock's ticking. And we've always been about the future. Now, what we're doing with our metal is what drives us, and that's exactly where we're at with Redeemer of Souls.
Couple more calls for Priest. AJ in Phoenix. Go ahead, AJ. You're on live with Richie and Rob and Glenn.
Yes, I have a question for Mr. Halford. Yes, Rob, my name is AJ. My question for you is this, sir. Who, you being as a singer, back, I remember I listened to all your music from, like, many years ago. Who are your influences as a singer-songwriter when you started out?
Well, I'm blessed, really, because, again, I think we're all blessed in Priest, because we grew up listening to some of them and being in the company of some of the most extraordinary musicians. You know, whether you go to places like the Beatles or the Stones, and then you immediately go to the world of Jimi Hendrix and The Who and Deep Purple, and we were around all of that great company for inspiration. And getting an understanding of the power of the early primitive roots of metal. So for me, it was everybody from Daltrey and Ian Gillan to early Bowie, Sinatra, Elvis. As a singer, I've always had a very broad approach to appreciate what the human voice can do, and I think that's probably come into play with me being able to use the voice in different textures.
Do you do a big vocal warm up? Do you have a big warm up?
No.
You don't do anything?
No, not now.
You just go straight on, man.
You know, it's amazing because our mutual dear late friend Ronnie James Dio, I'll never forget sitting backstage with him in his dressing room before he went on about 2006, and we're talking and having a drink, and his guy comes in and he says, Ronnie, 15 minutes to start. And this is when he's back in Sabbath. And I said, oh, Ronnie, let me go so you can get warmed up or whatever. He goes, where are you going? What do you mean warmed up? And he said, stay, hang out. Mm. And we walked to the stage together. And he said, you're going to bring us on? I said, sure. And I went out. Here comes Heaven and Hell. Mm-hmm. And he just walked out and belted out Neon Nights like nothing. And then I see guys that scream into a towel and they need 2 hours. You never did anything.
I used to, in all honesty, but for the last, I don't know how many tours, I just put down my cup of tea, go out there, and, you know, faster than a bullet! Top of the, you know, whatever.
I've tried to catch him.
He can still do it.
I do command. I do quite a lot of warming up before I go.
Do you? You scream into a towel, or you scream at Rob?
No, you don't pick up any towels in our dressing room.
It's dangerous. Our dressing room is toxic.
You don't know where they've been, man. You don't know where they've been.
Hey, speaking of Ronnie real quick, you did a tremendous version of Man on the Silver Mountain Dio tribute. That must have been...
It was a thrill. Yeah. And we because of the time constraints and everything that was going on with Priest, the instrumentation was put together by Doug and Jeff and Vinny and keyboard player Keith. So it was presented to me, and I just ran into a little studio in San Diego, and you know, I can't do a Ronnie. Ronnie's voice is extraordinary. I tried to sing in the same key, and it was killing me. I just couldn't get there, you know. And so I ended up doing about 6 or 7 takes of different ideas and just sent it back to the producer, and he did a wonderful job. But if you're going to copy something, you have to copy it to the note, and then it is a copy. And I'd like to think that our version is just a tribute, an homage to that particular track, and I think it turned out pretty good.
Couple more quick ones for Priest, then we got to let him get out of here. St. Louis, this is Ricky. Ricky, you're on with Judas Priest.
Oh, hey, guys.
Hey, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
I'm a big fan.
Thank you.
I always was wondering, because I'm only 19 years old right now, but I know you guys toured in the early 80s, and Eddie, you talk about this tour a lot. It was you guys and Iron Maiden. You guys on the Point of Entry tour, Iron Maiden on the Killers tour.
I was there. I was a young kid. My father waiting for me outside to pick me up on the way out. Fantastic. Convention Hall in Asbury Park, New Jersey. Still have the shirt. Doesn't fit, but... So what's the question, Ricky?
I was always wondering if you guys might ever do something like that again. Maybe not a full-blown tour, but, you know, maybe a few dates with Iron Maiden for the fans who, you know, are younger who didn't get to see that.
I want to do the big four: Black Sabbath, Judas Priest, Iron Maiden, and Led Zeppelin.
Wow! what stadium can you build that's big enough to hold that? Oh my gosh!
We do a month somewhere.
Rob, that's truly the big four. That is crazy, the big four.
There's none bigger than that four.
No. But assuming the only band not together of that big four is Zeppelin.
Yeah.
So you could make it the big three and still fill any...
Motorhead?
Yeah.
Yeah, you could put
it's
in...
four. Yeah. Big four.
Yeah.
That'd be immense.
Glenn's like, what are you thinking right now, Glenn?
People are going, where can I buy that ticket? I want that T-shirt.
I don't know, really. I was daydreaming a bit. There's certain great combinations out there of bands you put together. And I don't know whether you saw it the other night, but I watched the tribute to the Beatles. Did you see that program on the TV?
I did see it when it aired here. It aired here a while ago.
And we were just saying, you know, tragically, if John Lennon was still alive and the Beatles got back together, and George, of course, it would just be the biggest thing ever, the biggest band reunion of all time.
What do you think the biggest reunion out there is that could still happen? Zeppelin with Jason Bonham?
Zeppelin's got to be...
With Jason or Pink Floyd, as far as rock bands are concerned.
With Pink Floyd being out, you know, in the right,
but I mean Waters and Gilmour together.
Yeah, I mean, he did show up, didn't he, and play solo
on
the first one, so that was a sort of a reunion. But as regards bands getting back together, I think if Zeppelin did get back together, I think it would be monstrous.
Couple more quick ones. Anthony in Arkansas, go ahead. Anthony, you're on with Priest.
Hey, I was very fortunate to see you guys. I got in trouble for wearing your Ram It Down, Shove It Up shirt in high school. And I'm referring to that concert in Chicago. When the power went out on stage, I'm all the way at the back of the venue, and I could hear Rob Halford still singing, all for the audience. The guitars were out. You could still hear the drums. Everything else was gone. Rob, that was very impressive. I just wanted to congratulate you on that.
Thank you very much.
Could have been one of the best concerts I've ever seen.
Wow.
Do you remember that, Rob?
No. It's a blur. I'm sorry.
He said the sound went out on everything but your mic.
What year was that? Did he say?
He said it was in Chicago. He said the soundboard went out. It sounds like maybe you tipped the sound guy a little bit. Kill everybody else and just leave my mic on.
we had the same thing recently, but the other way around. I mean, Rob was the one that cut out, and we carried on. And we had to do the song again, didn't we? We started the show. It was the first song of the set.
Rapid Fire.
The vocals cut out. So and we didn't really know. You know, you're into it and you're blasting out the metal. And then you realise something's up, you know. And what's that? Oh, it's no Halford. So we had to, you know, take 5 minutes to just reconstruct everything. And then, so that's a fun moment, you know. It's one of those rock and roll, looking back on it's always fun, you know.
That's
but at the
what
time,
should happen in rock and roll. You know, it's supposed to be unpredictable.
When the kabuki didn't fall down the one night and we had to play the first number anonymously behind it, that was...
What was that again? What happened, Glenn?
Is it a kabuki? Is that my saying the wrong word?
Yeah.
It's a scrim that you put in front of all the equipment at the front of the stage.
Uh-huh.
So at the chosen point explosion goes off and it drops, so nobody sees it. Suddenly you're on stage. It didn't drop, so we had to play the first number on the curtain. That was on the last tour as well. It was quite interesting.
That's a good Spinal Tap moment right there.
Yeah, yeah. Sometimes it drops too early as well, doesn't it? It's happened where it drops and we're standing
on top of you.
All right, I want to end with this then. Along those lines, let's go around the horn here. Give me the greatest Spinal Tap-ish Priest mishap in your 40-year career, Glenn. Do you have a story, like the most absurd thing that happened on stage? That comes to mind?
We were talking about this earlier. One that springs to mind that I mentioned earlier on today, actually. We finished the set one night in the early days, and we ran off stage into the dressing room, and Rob, he was so full of adrenaline. He got this set of step ladders and just threw it aimlessly. It hit me on the head and split my head up. So I had to go on and play the encores with the blood pumping out of my head. You could see it. You know, the veins stick out of your head when you're on stage. You know, the adrenaline's pumping. And the audience going, look at that. That's a great effect, you know.
Glenn Tipton is so metal. Bleeding to death for metal.
The very first show I ever did with the band, we got some homemade PA, and they exploded. And all this stuff came out like a blizzard. The audience thought it was fantastic. We had to do the whole show without a PA. That was my first introduction to Priest and Birmingham Town Hall, which is quite a big gig for us at the time. It was our own. There's been so many. I'm sure Rob...
That would be a good book.
Give me one, yeah. Rob. Give me one from your end.
We were talking about this one incident. It was the very beginnings of Priest. We were playing a club venue. And even then, we were trying to think of things to put in the show. So before we went on, I noticed in the corner of this really crappy dressing room, there were like these big cardboard tubes, but they'd been painted silver, so they looked like scaffolding, like metal. So I said to Glenn, I'll tell you what, like when you're doing Genocide or whatever it was, I'll come up and start hitting you with this thing, but I'll pull back because it's, you know, it'll look like, well, you know, he's hitting the guitar player with these metal bars. So I did it, and of course, again, in the adrenaline, I just got carried away, and I'm beating the hell out of him.
Beating the shit out of me.
They weren't tubes. It was solid. It was like these big solid pieces of whatever, like 2x4, and I'm smashing it on him, and Glenn's going like, oh, my God, stuff. And I'm thinking, oh, he's getting into it, so I'll get into it even more, and I'm beating the hell out of him. He's crumpled on the floor trying to play on his guitar on his knees, and I'm still going at it. And he's like, stop it. You know, it's the real deal, Tom. So... instances like that are
the worst thing was on the very last time he hit me, the thing snapped and came around and hit me in the face as well, so more or less knocked me out. But the audience thought it was all intentional, so yeah.
Somehow all the pranks end up with Glenn bleeding somehow.
I don't know why that is.
Now, Richie, you've only got 3 years in, but do you have a story? Do you have a good one?
Well, the one that sticks in my mind is, I know it's happened before in the band's career, but we were in South America, Brazil, I think, and Rob's gone out on the bike, and the metal god takes it upon himself to drive it just a little bit further around the stage, you know, do an extra lap of the stage.
He's
on the big Harley, you know, so he drives the Harley onto the stage, as he normally does, and he normally stops about halfway in the middle of the stage, but not tonight, you know. He pumped up, I guess, and decides to drive it, do another lap around the stage, and he drives it into the side fill, and I'm watching him disappear. I'm thinking, what's he doing? And then he hits the side fill, the Harley goes over, and for a split second you think, is he all right? You know, where is he? And then up he jumps, picks up the Harley, gets back on it, and sings the rest of the set on the Harley. But, you know, but it's that moment, that initial moment when it goes down. You know, is he all right? Is he hurt?
Sure.
I think, but sure enough, up he jumps, back on the Harley, whips chains and everything. You know, so.
Oh, man. Well, good stuff. Thank you.
Life and death on the road.
Yeah. Thank you all so much for coming
in.
It's great to see you. We'll do something more when we have more from the record.
We'll come see you in July. We're going to come back and see you release week, July 15th. So everybody tune in. We'll come and see
you
again.
So we're not getting our 19 seconds. Jane is walking out. No 19 seconds.
She's got a vice-like grip on that CD.
It's not going to happen.
But we want to do something with you as well, Eddie, separately, which we'll talk about later.
Okay.
As an exclusive for our fans here in New York.
That. Thank you. Yeah, for sure.
We'll talk about that.
Anything you want to do.
Thanks for everything. Thank you, everybody that's listening out in Sirius Land, all the trunk heads, as we affectionately call you. And keep banging your heads to the metal and listening to the inimitable, encyclopedic
godfather of heavy metal, Eddie Trunk.
Oh, thank you so much for that. I'm going to play something from another great record, recent record, Angel of Retribution, to let you guys go. Maybe a little Deal with the Devil, I think. And fantastic. Glenn, were you going to say something? Because you're on. You're
just goodbye, Eddie. I hadn't said goodbye, so I was going to say goodbye.
I appreciate that. Well, I was going to say goodbye to you when we started the song, okay. Anyway. But, unless you got to run right out. But good seeing you, Richie.
Thanks for having us, man.
All
see
right.
You soon.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, guys.